Brought to you by Penguin.
How Confidence Works by Professor Ian Robertson. Read by Professor Ian Robertson. For Fiona, who taught me about the mind, with love and thanks. Introduction. Suppose we were to discover something that could make us wealthier, healthier, longer living, smarter, kinder, happier, more motivated, more innovative. Ridiculous, you might say, but in fact, we already have. And what is this elixir? Confidence. And it is to human endeavour what food is to the body. Without either, we would wither and die. If you have it, it can empower you to reach heights you never thought possible. But if you don't, it can have a devastating effect on your prospects, despite your objective achievements. When tennis legend Venus Williams was asked, age 14, on ABC News, how confident she was about beating her opponent in a tough upcoming match, she responded by saying, "I'm very confident." The reporter replied, a little surprised, "You say it so easily. Why?" "Because I believe it," the future champion replied, matter-of-factly. Interviewed nearly 25 years later in 2018 by the New York Times, she said, "I feel that I owe my own success to my belief in myself, and have found that confidence can be learned and developed. In fact, my own self-confidence is something I work on every day, just like going to the gym or training on the court." This book will probe the science and neuroscience behind the idea that confidence can be learned, or whether it is necessarily something you inherit. Optimism, hope, and self-esteem are all concepts that are easily confused with confidence, but, as I will show, they differ in one fundamental way. Confidence empowers action. You can be an optimist who is hopeful that things will work out okay in the end, without ever believing that you can play a part in that outcome. Or, indeed, having any realistic grounds for that optimism. And you can have high self-esteem and feel good about yourself without feeling confident that you can achieve a particular goal. The future is uncertain. Confidence is a mental stance towards the future that defies this uncertainty by betting on success. Self-belief is a calculated wager on oneself that often wins because it is a bet based on past performance. Confidence creates the future because it is grounded in action. And, as Venus Williams said, it can be learned. Confidence is made up of two parts. The first is the bet you make with yourself that you can do something. This is the can-do element. The second is a belief that if you do that thing, then the world will change a little. This is the can-happen part. Maybe you believe that you can take more exercise. Can do. But you doubt that it will make you lose weight. Can't happen. Or say you accept that if everyone were to cut down their fossil fuel use, we could reduce global warming. Can happen. But you don't think you can do this yourself. Can't do. For confidence to work its full-blooded magic, it requires a potent combination of can-do about the inner world and can-happen about the external world. Confidence, therefore, lies at the core of what makes things happen. It is a bridge to the future. It is that uniquely human capacity to visualize something that does not yet exist and work towards achieving it. For millennia, it has been the driver of all of humanity's advances, from the medical breakthroughs that have lengthened our lives to the sending of NASA's Voyager 1 spacecraft out into the Milky Way. On 25th of May 1961, US President John F. Kennedy announced to a special joint session of the US Congress that his country would land a man on the moon before the end of the decade. He had no idea how this would be achieved. The rockets, the technology and the know-how didn't exist when he made that speech. But, spurred on by the Soviet Union's recent dramatic successes in space travel, he was able to envisage that imaginary future event and express the confidence that it would happen. And it did, on 20th of July 1969. This achievement did not rest on the personal confidence of one man. Kennedy was galvanizing and expressing the faith of an entire country in their common goal. So I am not just talking about individuals here. Confidence, or the lack of it, can be collective. In news bulletins, we hear phrases such as consumer confidence, market confidence, business confidence, and even national confidence. So how does personal confidence relate to these broader economic and political concepts? Economics and politics can bleed into the self-belief of millions of individual people, and vice versa. For example, studies have shown that 18 to 25-year-olds who lived through an economic recession believe less strongly that they can get ahead by their hard work. This was starkly illustrated during the economic turmoil caused by the COVID-19 pandemic of 2020. In a UK study of 2,000 16 to 25-year-olds, 41% said that their future goals seemed impossible to achieve, and 38% felt they would now never succeed in life. Such a dramatic drop in the confidence levels of almost half a generation will reverberate for decades in the social, economic, and political fabric of the UK and elsewhere. Economic good times make it easier for young people to have the confidence to aspire and achieve. But individual confidence is so central to national development that it will be much harder for countries that have experienced a hemorrhage of confidence among their youthful population to return to those economic good times. Confidence also matters because self-confident people live longer, happier, and healthier lives. For example, studies have shown that you will live longer after heart failure if your partner feels confident about your condition. And confidence is contagious. Families, communities, and whole countries can rise and fall depending on how confidence, or the loss of it, spreads. The gradual decline of Rust Belt communities in the US from the 1980s was caused not only by industrial closures, but also by a viral contagion of low confidence that sapped people's morale and drove away the ambitious problem solvers. And as with individual confidence, collective confidence can also be learned, as we will see later in the book. Research shows how such contagion can also spread through families, sports, businesses, neighbourhoods, and whole countries. As confidence waxes and wanes, we see profound changes in the physiology of the brain and the rest of the body. For example, feeling confident about being able to face up to something you're frightened of actually boosts your immune system, despite the fear you feel. The confidence makes it much more likely that you will face up to your anxiety. The opposite is also true. If you lack confidence in your ability to cope with what scares you, you will be less likely to deal with it successfully. So what is it, this thing we call confidence? We think we know it when we see it, but we can only really understand it by delving into the remarkable scientific research that has emerged in recent decades. How does confidence play out in our minds, our brains, and indeed our bodies? Where does it come from, and how does it spread? Is it universal, or does it play out?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.